just like a car battery.
This is our simulation of a lunar lander arriving at the moon.
Actually, I kind of like that.
Ready?
Yep. In 3, 2, 1.
Look, as you can tell, it's very, very crude, but there's one extremely accurate part, the dirt. This is lunar regolith simulant, or fake moon soil. It was made by a lab that's part of a small but growing cottage industry. It turns out that soil on the moon is nothing like its cousin here on Earth. It's weird, unpredictable, and even dangerous. And as more missions aim for the moon,
back to the moon and beyond,
simulant is helping avoid some potentially catastrophic run-ins with the real stuff.
That's everywhere.
Down a little bit, fly.
So these are samples of simulated lunar regolith, which experts will call lunar soil or dirt or dust. We got these samples by ordering them on the internet. And the story of why it's so readily available is actually kind of fascinating. And it starts with this.
Yeah, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
The first samples taken of the moon during the Apollo program confirmed that lunar regolith is strange and nasty stuff. See, there's no real atmosphere on the moon, so meteorites have pounded its bedrock into a mix of sharp, jagged particles and lots of dust. And without wind or rain to weather that down, the surface stays jagged and dusty forever. Meteorites also melt the soil on impact and create little shards of glassy material called agglutinate. And that soil is constantly being baked by solar wind, causing chemical changes in the minerals themselves. It's an utterly alien material. And during the Apollo missions, it got everywhere. It messed with instrument readings, tore up spacesuits, clogged equipment, irritated astronauts' eyes and lungs. Real bad news. NASA's solution was to make fake lunar soil here on Earth to better prep their hardware before putting it to work on the moon. Now, they've made and tested lots of simulants over the years, and more recently have pulled in private businesses to help with large-scale production. That was a smart move because these days, we're in a bit of a moon boom.
NASA says it's opening a brand new chapter in lunar exploration.
Beijing's goal? To put its own astronauts on the moon by 2030.
Four-stage engine start.
With Artemis and many other missions on the horizon, the simulant business is brisk.
Our community does challenge us, and they push us very hard, because they're like, okay, I need 3 kilograms. And we're like, here you go. And they're like, okay, can you give us like 50? And we're like, all right, give me a little bit of time. We got this. And then they're like, all right, so now give me 50 tons.
Exolith Lab is one of NASA's primary suppliers of lunar simulants, and they walked us through their process for making the stuff from scratch. It starts with a question. Where on the moon do you want to simulate?
So when you look at the moon, the lighter regions is what we call the highlands, and then the mare regions are the darker spots. So the mineralogy there is pretty different.
So let's consider this highland sample. Based on studies of real lunar samples, the recipe from Exolith is a bunch of anorthosite, a little basalt, and a smidge of ilmenite, pyroxene, and olivine. First, the team sources the raw materials from mines and other suppliers. Some of it arrives pre-crushed, other samples, not so much.
It's very much like a mining operation. Some of our materials come in big boulders. So what we do is we throw them in one crusher, then we throw them in another huge crusher. We also have to sieve it out. A lot of the processing that we do on our materials through the crushing also helps them achieve that desired shape, that desired jaggedness that we're looking for.
Now, for more bespoke orders, they can even mix in some simulated agglutinate. That's the strange glassy material. Finally, all the ingredients get mixed together in the proper ratio.
It's kind of like baking. What you do is you follow a recipe, you weigh out the different materials, and then we let it mix for a while until it's nice and homogeneous.
Just like that, you've got moon dirt. So what are folks actually doing with simulants? Well, all kinds of things. They're figuring out how to dig into it, navigate rovers through it, grow plants in it, extract oxygen from it. All the things we need to do to spend more time on the moon. Now, no one simulant is a perfect stand-in for all of those experiments. It's just too hard to make a replica that's perfect in every way. But different simulants can get pretty close on individual features like the size and shape of particles or of the chemical composition. So researchers can order the right simulants for the right test.
Rolling.
So this is gonna shake a lot.
Learning about all that work inspired us to do something with our samples. So we thought we'd look at a problem that could really jeopardize our long-term plans on the moon. It starts when you point a rocket engine at all that dusty, jagged regolith.
That was insane.
Nice.
When you try to land a rocket on the moon, the rocket exhaust is coming out at thousands of meters per second.
Phil Metzger and his colleagues have spent 20-odd years studying what happens next, which looks roughly like this. When rocket exhaust hits the moon, it sends up a huge plume of high-speed regolith, like it would on Earth if you were to land a rocket somewhere without a launch pad. But with low gravity and no real atmosphere, that soil travels.
There is no distance on the moon that is far enough away to be safe from some particles hitting at that distance.
Meaning smaller particles from a single landing can shoot across the entire moon.
And therefore, anything that's exposed to that spray is going to be hit by particles going thousands of meters per second.
We actually even have an example of this. In November 1969, Apollo 12 touched down near Surveyor 3, which is an uncrewed NASA craft that landed a couple years before.
They landed 160 meters away because at the time they thought that was far enough away so that the rocket exhaust wouldn't damage the Surveyor. Turns out that was, you know, a vast under prediction of how far the ejecta goes. So when they got the pieces back from Surveyor 3 back to Earth, they found out they were completely sandblasted. The coatings were worn off, the paint was completely penetrated and filled with lunar dust particles. It completely eroded the entire surface of the Surveyor.
As the lunar economy heats up and the moon gets more crowded, these tiny little particles could cause bigger and bigger problems. Damage from regolith plumes could cost a lot of money, put future missions at risk, even cause geopolitical trouble.
Because if one country lands on the moon and then sandblasts and damages the hardware of another country, then technically you're violating the Outer Space Treaty because you're not allowed to do any harm to other countries' assets in space. There's also a concern about countries claiming an excessively large blast zone, which could be a way to get around the Outer Space Treaty and claim de facto territory on the moon.
Fortunately, there are lots of solutions on the table. You could standardize landing zones for everybody, using the moon's hills and valleys as shields, even building launch pads out of regolith. And Simulant is powering a lot of that R&D. NASA's busy testing regolith-based construction materials and doing much more thoughtful versions of our little experiment. There's still a lot more work to be done, but Phil says there's also been a lot more recognition of the issue than there used to be, which feels like a win.
If there was anything that I could consider to be my life's work, I think that would be it. But yeah, I feel really good about where we are and where it's been so far.
Of course, humanity has its sights set farther than the moon, and we have regolith for that too. I mean, here's some Mars regolith full of different minerals and properties. The point is, the need for this stuff isn't going anywhere. And there's a virtuous cycle to it too. I mean, the more simulant that's available, the more it gets used here on Earth. And maybe the more missions happen out there.
The more that people have access to doing things like this kind of research with our stuff, the more it's going to perpetuate that curiosity. So I do feel like being a part of it as it's happening.
And lift off of Artemis 1.
And then also helping it become more available to everyone is going to kind of make that happen even more rapidly.
So imagine being on a planet. Covered in this stuff. It's sweeping forever.
Don't sweep up the lunar rover.